Rocky Point was a kind of a gathering place for fishermen. All sorts of drifters, like, they would get some nets and move into a tent or something and fish there. Mm-hmm. And sometimes they would fish with my dad, and I'd get out of have to paddle the boat.
Mm-hmm.
And Bill Coos was one of them. He had a heart of gold. He said, man, he'd help us hay, of course, too, and
mm-hmm.
He'd get his meals, because even though they were batching, they were always over. They'd get some of that venison and
mm-hmm.
Good sour cream gravy with dumplings. Oh, man. Old Charlie Fickerly, he just say, don't look what I'm doing, Mrs. Herman, but I'm going to take more. He says, I can't stop.
And now your dad settled. He came, didn't you tell me he came over on the boat? You know, up the river from Thief River?
I really don't even know how my dad got there, to be honest with you.
Okay.
But my mother came by the boat.
Oh, okay.
She came by train to Redby.
Okay.
And at Redby, she hired Albert Smith. She already had two children then with her. She had Charlie and Jerry. I wasn't even born then. Not for quite a few years. And when they got, they crossed the lakes naturally and took her to the homestead that my dad had acquired. And they couldn't, the lake was low, they couldn't get into shore, so they had to carry everything, you know, out of the lake bottom up on the dry ground. My dad wasn't anywhere around. He was over with his brother, helping him build on his house. And so she came with the two kids, just unloaded on the shore and left. Albert cranked up his little engine and left again, left her there alone. Well, she sat there, she sat for about 2 hours with the two boys,
mm-hmm.
trying to keep the mosquitoes and stuff off. And finally my dad came walking down the lakeshore and kind of took over.
Mm.
But she was, I just marvel at the stamina that my mother had. There's a lot of denial in that by the government. They denied that it was A-bombing, and yet, in my mind, I know it was, and I know that out of 23 of the people that were kind of associated with the place and were exposed, that 13 of them, most of them already died from cancer and brain tumors.
Mm.
So I said, that's over 50%. And I said that to me. But when that bomb would go off during the night, it would just seem to squeeze the house together.
Mm.
And then it would release, as opposed as the pressure went by. And you could hear the house tearing apart. In this house, all the partitions tore loose of the walls. The basement cracked, the chimney cracked, and dishes, of course, rattled, but that's beside the point. And at the resort, it broke up the chimneys, even broke the windows at Rocky Point Resort.
Hmm.
And in the end, I'm getting this kind of muddled together, but shortly after the bombing, about maybe four or five years, my wife got cancer, and then later years I got a brain tumor, and now I've got cancer.
Oh.
And my son has cancer. the whole goddamn family. I've got some of those articles on the downwinders, and that's what it kind of reminds me of. We were downwinders because the wind, prevailing wind, is from the west. Of bombing took place 6 miles west of here. So all the residue kind of would have drifted this way.
Yeah.
And according to some people from Minneapolis that came and checked the radiation, they found that my brother Charlie's, they found so much radiation in the rain barrel. He had a rain barrel.
They did?
He said that the thing just slammed against the post and couldn't go any further. The needle, that is. And all the guys said, you're loaded. Well, I can remember as a kid, when you walked the lakeshore, and we walked it many times to Waskish and over to Deer Creek, because we used to pick blueberries there, and there were some hazelnuts and stuff. About every eighth of a mile was a little creek coming into the lake, and they say that up around the Lost River or Tamarack River, where the people settled, the Dakins and a bunch of others, that it just was a paradise. Those little creeks were taking care of themselves by nature. They were clean. The fish were in there spawning. But then when the dredges came along, like at Tamarack, they dredged all the way from Popple Island, which is 14 miles. They dredged the ditch and dumped it into the Tamarack River. There is no way that that little river, it's so narrow when you get in the back, can handle that. So all the people that bought land after the ditches went in were flooded out. They said that water just came rushing down those ditches and just everything went under. Cattle were floating in the water, and he said we had to get out. I had a hunch things weren't setting too good, and I thought this is the only road out of here. 6 miles of road where a game warden can stop you anywhere. I said, I'm going to try the lake. And it was frozen, oh God, maybe about a block out or so. And I managed, when I loaded up the deer, to sneak along the weeds and get all the way to the highway along the lakeshore. Got him over to the condos and peddled them and got my money. Started for home. I got over here to this corner. There's three game warden cars, two pickups. The game warden that, Falk, I think, that worked here in Waskish, he was there. And he walks over to the car and he looks at me. He says, how in the, he says, did you get out? They were laying there for me to come with those deer. Somebody had tipped them off, and I followed the lake and got out.
And with your car, you followed the lake? You drove, oh my gosh.
Boy, he was just kind of livid. He just looked like a beet. First, we rigged up a Model A, and Charlie made his home idea of a propeller, and we put it on, and by God, we harvested, I think, about 35 wolves with it that fall. And there was a $35 bounty and on the big wolves, $25 on the small wolves, and $3 on a fox. So next year, we bought an airplane motor, and we built another sled. And we just had the time of our life. My God, we could shoot around these two lakes, leave at 8 o'clock and be home at 10 or 10:30, patrolling both lakes. Ooh. And one time we caught four timber wolves out on the lake. There was three males after one female. Mm-hmm. And we tackled the biggest male first, thinking he'd be the easiest, you know, subdue him and shoot him and quit get at the others before they get into shore. And I, when he was already down, I jumped out of the sled and I was going to shoot him in the head to finish him so that we were sure he'd stay. And he jumped up and came at me. And when I swung the shotgun, I shot him right into the mouth and blew the back of his head off. Of course, that was the end of it. But anyway, we got the other three too. So in about an hour and a half, we made $140. We felt pretty good about that.